Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edisec live lecture. Dear friends, as you know that in our previous session we discussed on Shakespeare Macbeth. Today also we would be getting deep analysis on Shakespeare's one of the another creations, and today we are going to discuss on Othello. Dear friends, for this we have again with us in our studios Professor Anand Prakash. Professor Prakash is a retired professor from the Department of English, University of Delhi. Let's take advantages from his immense knowledge, as well as let's try to understand more and more through him about Shakespeare's Othello. So without wasting any time, I would like to welcome our guest Professor Anand Prakash. Professor Prakash, welcome to the Edisec lecture.
Thank you, Gitika. And welcome, viewers. As has been announced, today's discussion would be on Shakespeare's Othello. And in the beginning, I'll make a general remark regarding Shakespeare's texts. The series, you know, is being presented under the, title, The Great Literary Texts. And when I discuss Shakespeare, and I've discussed a few plays by him already, I realize that every text has its own, atmosphere, its own culture, its own specificity, its own character. So when I start reading a play, then I feel as if I were entering a new territory, a new country, a country with a specific culture, which has its own laws. And those laws, govern the behavior of the people. Who are there in the text. At the same time, I'm aware while reading the text that it's not merely another country or another culture, it's also another time. Shakespeare belonged to the, late 16th, early 17th century, and he lived at a time, which we don't understand directly, we have not experienced it directly, and for us it's a kind of history. The history of England, for instance, in the 16th and the 17th centuries. So it's a different country and it's a different time segment, because of which I realized right in the beginning that there is a sense of excitement in me as to what this play would, present to me, as an experience, as a series of events, as characters who belong to another era and who talk to me. Rather than talking to themselves, one another, they also talk to me through the text. And I realize that I'm meeting new people all the time when I read a Shakespeare text. Another dimension of this particular point would be that when Shakespeare wrote a play, then he specifically kept in mind certain countries or a particular country. And that country would not be England always. It would be another country, another European country. And sometimes it wouldn't be a country at all, it will be an island which has remained uninhabited for a long time. So therefore we have, this particular fascinating aspect of Shakespeare's texts. Shakespeare is preparing himself, first he's preparing himself and then he's preparing the audience to come across, to come in touch with a new country and a new set of people. And when I say that it's a new country and with a different kind of atmosphere, cultural atmosphere, then I realize that perhaps I'm going to be educated in the manners of another country. So I read the text and then I confront this problem, and I'm sure that all of you would be concerned with this particular aspect. Also, when Shakespeare chose to write about a certain country and about a certain time segment, he prepared himself intellectually. He prepared himself, as a literary writer also. He had to present things quite authentically, and he would study a lot. It appears from the details that emerge in the text that Shakespeare would have studied the atmosphere of the place and the time, in which he sets his tale, he sets his, set of events. And therefore, it's not easy to write about another country and a country at a different point of time. So Shakespeare's studies would be enormous. He would be reading a lot. And in fact, at the level of vocabulary also, Shakespeare would be enriching us and would be enriching his audience, because every play that Shakespeare writes has a different kind of vocabulary. Words do not mean the same thing, in other plays as they mean in the play that one is reading at a particular time. So imagine the kind of vocabulary Shakespeare would have. Imagine the kind of knowledge he would have about cultures. Imagine his range of interests. And, you know, there is a binding thread at the same time. So every play is different from, another. And yet, there is a person behind those plays. There is a person behind that performance which is done on the stage, that is Shakespeare himself. So you would know that even though different places, are being presented in different texts, the writer being one unified and integrated would show, that Shakespeare has a general message also to put across. So this is the point I thought I should share with you. And I would like to, ask Geetika whether, this kind of a point makes sense in the context of Shakespeare, that one is coming across, one is coming in touch with a different kind of a reality, a different kind of a set of people. So Geetika, what do you say on this?
Yes, definitely. I would say, sir, if somebody is coming a different kind of point of view with different kind of reality, one is appreciated, I think so.
And particularly, as you rightly said, particularly in the case of India. So we have, that kind of a distance from what Shakespeare is going to tell us. And even the English audience of Shakespeare's plays today would feeling a bit odd. Would be feeling a bit, untouched and uninfluenced by what Shakespeare would tell them. And later on, of course, one, becomes familiarized with the atmosphere of a particular text, and then one gradually becomes a part of it. So this is what I felt particularly with respect to this play, Othello, which has taken up as background the country, called... I seem to forget the country at the moment. I think it's Venice. Yes, it's a country called Venice. And in fact, there are two. There is another play also, and at the moment I'm not sure. Maybe there is a third play also. But then, like Merchant of Venice, this play also is situated in Venice. So Venetian law operates, Venetian authorities appear, and Venetian characters appear, and Venice at that time was a country which was visited by people from other countries also, and in this case, Shakespeare makes it very relevant to Venice, because there is a person who is going to be the protagonist of the country, Othello, and this person doesn't belong to Venice. He is not a Venetian. He has come from elsewhere. In fact, he has come from a country which would be somewhere at the top of South Africa, north of Africa. So he has come from there, and he is being referred to again and again by characters in the play as a Moor. So he's a Moor, and a Moor is not an Englishman. A Moor may not be a Christian also. And that will pose problems for him. He's very important. He's that way, very reliable for the security of the country. He's a big fighter, but then he doesn't belong to Venice. And I'll talk about this aspect later. But then Shakespeare would keep this country in mind, and at a time when different, citizens from other countries, they would visit, and some of them would settle down and accept the kind of citizenship of the place. So after making this point, I, straight away go to the central theme, the basic, message that Shakespeare would convey through a subject that he takes up for representation. And that subject, as I would define for myself, for the benefit of sharing my views with you, would be the concern of Shakespeare here is the theme of love. If somebody falls in love, somebody decides to spend one's whole life with another person, another human being, another citizen, one likes that person. On that personal liking is based the relationship, which well would be defined as love in the modern context, and at that time also in the Renaissance context. So this play is about the theme of love, and love is not that way, universally accepted, or all those things that we say about love today. Love, is a part of social life, and there are times, when love can create difficulties for the humans, for the human beings who accept this as their guiding principle of life. So the theme of love is there, but love doesn't occur in a vacuum. Shakespeare knows about it. Shakespeare also wants to tell this to his audience, that love doesn't work in a vacuum. And if there's a theme of love, then there'll be problems of culture, problems of ideas, problems of moral principles, problems of, you know, settling down at a place with a person who belongs to another culture. So this Moor, that is Othello, who is a big general, he is going to fall in love with, he is in fact already in love with when the play opens, with a woman called Desdemona. And the two have in fact secretly married. I say secretly because Othello would be apprehensive that you know, if he announced his love, for a girl, to his friends and to the other people whom he knows, then there will be an opposition in the country. He's an outsider. So an outsider, you know, marrying a local girl, that is going to create a lot of problems, you know, for the two lovers. And that seems to be the theme of Shakespeare. So what is love? Whether love is one-sided, whether mutuality in love can ensure a stability in life, all these points will be taken up, you know, together by Shakespeare. And then, of course, Shakespeare doesn't discuss it as a theme. Shakespeare presents it as an experience in which different characters are a part. So it's about love, which is supposed to be universal to human beings, you know, decide to like each other. When they like each other, then they would like to spend time with one each other, and so on and so forth. And, you know, then they would realize gradually, if they don't realize in the beginning itself, that it's not acceptable to the social setup in which they live. And they have to contend with, they have to struggle against, this kind of a social setup to make themselves acceptable. So this is the theme of Othello. He's in love with Desdemona. Desdemona is a local Venetian woman belonging to the upper class. The Moor, that is Othello, he comes from another country, he has settled down here. He's a soldier, he's a general, and he's one of the best fighters that, you know, Venice has. And in that sense, you know, he has to be accepted, not merely as one of them, but also as an important person, a dignitary. And, you know, in the play, after some time, this person will show that kind of a valor, that kind of a bravery, that he'll be made the governor of another country, which, you know, Venice has to fight with, and that country is defeated, the armies are defeated. And then this person, who is central to the struggle there, you know, between two armies, then he is made the governor of Cyprus, which was taken over by Venice at the time when the play is engaging with, you know, this question. So love that way is not neutral. Love is not unconnected. Love is an integral part of a society. And if there are conflicts in society, as there are in all societies, and there are in Venice in this particular case, then those conflicts will visit upon the characters who indulge in, who take part in, who are a party to the relationship of love. So this is the central theme. And not that Shakespeare is talking only about this. Shakespeare is talking about the complex situation in which this particular question is placed. And then, you know, the play opens up a large number of political, economic, social possibilities. And if those possibilities are stronger than the characters who can bear them, then of course the end can be predicted. The end would be negative. It will be a kind of a tragedy. And as it happens, you know, the play ends in a kind of a tragedy, both lovers dying at the end. And imagine the poison of racism and the poison of individual, you know, traits is so strong in the case of Othello. No, not the woman. The woman is very pure till the end. You know, the poison of this kind of a separatism, this kind of a racism, and other things that work, you know, in the mind of the character Othello, that poison is so strong that towards the end, Othello, with his own hands, will kill his wife and his beloved under an impression which appears to be false, which is accepted as false at the end. It is proved to be false, but by that time that he realizes this, the game has been already over. So it's a tragedy. It's a tale of love. It's a description of conflicts of interests, conflicts of social classes, social groups, etc. And that's how the play has been conceived. And the play is on a grand scale. All of us know it. It's not about a neighborhood love affair. It's not about a street love affair. It's not about a city alone. It is it's not confined to that kind of individual, territory. It's a question that relates to the entire city of Venice, the entire country called Venice, and it also then moves from this place, Venice, to another part, that is Cyprus. So then still more interesting, who is actually the carrier of the prejudice of racism, or any kind of a prejudice against this couple which is in love. And they are very fine people. They are very sweet. Othello is very dignified. If you can think of two or three dignified characters in the whole of Shakespeare, then Othello is going to be one of them. He's a very fine person. He's helpful. He's cool and calm. He's a great fighter, he's not given to any kind of an excitement or provocation. And when such a person, to whom the entire city looks up to, the entire country looks up to, if this person meets this kind of an end, then things are really serious, and Shakespeare wants to make us aware of these serious things. So I come to this character of Iago in the play, and Iago is a Venetian, and Iago and Othello have not pulled along with each other well. Othello may not even know that Iago exists. In that sense in which I am talking, he knows Iago. In fact, he has already employed Iago under him to serve him, and Iago seems to be his favorite till the end of the play. Othello doesn't realize that this person is the villain, that this person is creating all kinds of situations in which there is a web-like structure that will emerge, and Othello will be caught in this. He doesn't know it till the end, till the last moment. Othello doesn't know that Iago is the person who is, playing on his emotions, playing on his mind, and that it is he who has planned his, death the killing of Desdemona at his hands. Othello doesn't know about this. So, who is Iago? Iago is called an ancient. He is called an ensign also. So he is a slightly lower rank officer who has to assist the big general, and he can always, general can always depute one of his assistants, and lower down in the rank is Iago, who will accompany him, who will manage his affairs, who will meet his visitors, who will give them time, who will regulate all kinds of things. So he's a kind of private secretary in his role, and he's called an ensign. There is another person in the play called Cassio. Now, Cassio is placed higher than Iago, and he also is supposed to serve. So, Cassio is the lieutenant, and Iago is the ensign or the ancient, and Othello is the general. So, these three people have to work together wherever they go, and they have worked together in Venice. And now, Othello has to leave the place to defend his country against attack, and then when he goes to Cyprus, then of course, Othello has to take these people along. So imagine, Othello is carrying his enemies all along with him. In fact, the second person is not his enemy. Second person is his friend, but he is not as mentally strong and alert as Iago is. So Iago, in fact, in the list of characters in the play, is called the villain. Who is the villain? The person who is driven by motives of death, destruction, blocking the way of progress of the main character, and who brings about the downfall of the protagonist. That person is the villain. In fact, sometimes we have this phrase like the villain of the piece. It has two meanings. One is that of the piece means of the work which we are reading, and that the villain is there, and in the larger sense that this is the main person who will be treating the protagonist as his enemies. So all of us know the meaning of villain. We, in our Hindi films, we have villains always, and there is a fight between the hero and the villain, so one knows what a villain is. And in this case, if Othello is the hero, Iago is the villain. And why is he, villainous? Why? What motive does he have that he opposes every move of Othello throughout the play, and finally is successful in getting Desdemona killed by his hands, and then Othello dying himself also, he commits suicide. So why does he do it? And books have been written on this. A large number of debates have happened about this play as to why the villain was behaving in the villainous way. What was his motive? Why would he do it? And nobody has found any satisfactory answer for this. Iago is that kind of villain, some critics have used a very interesting phrase. They say this person has in him what can be called motiveless malignity. It's a malignity. It's an evil. It's a disease. It's a deadly thing in him that is motiveless. There's no motive. He's born villain. He's a born villain. So this is the kind of thing that people say, which means that they don't understand, they can't explain, and most of us can't explain why Iago is a villain. Towards the end, when Iago is caught, and he is caught in the last few pages of the text, at that point of time somebody asks him, why did you do it? And then he says, well, from now onwards, I will never speak word. And he goes quiet. And then they say they'll torture him and get the effects out of him, and he's taken away, and that's how the play ends. But then Iago is that kind of a finished, that kind of a villain, who has absolutely no qualms of conscience in him. He will always work against goodness. He will always work against morality. He will use somebody's goodness against that person in such a manner, in such an intelligent manner, that the other person just won't know how to tackle him. And in fact, it's at the level of playwriting, at the level of writing the play, at the level of presenting the sequences and things on the stage, one is fascinated by the way Iago is able to handle the whole affair in a negative fashion. So he's in fact pulling the strings. He's using different characters as if they are playthings in his hands. They are toys. And he was just pulling this string and that string, and whatever dialogue he would give, then the character speaks that dialogue. So this kind of a thing, and some critics even say that the actual writer of the play is not Shakespeare of this play. The actual writer is Iago. He's writing the script of Othello, and therefore he should be called the actor. And one scholar has gone to the extent of saying, and this is in Delhi University, a professor called Professor Desai, he even said that Iago is not just a writer of the play, he is also a director of the play, because he tells people how to behave, how to enact scenes, etc. So that kind of a fascinating aspect of Iago should not be lost sight of. And when you read the play, you really start enjoying the villainy, because this villainy is so very intellectual, is so very sharp, razor sharp. It is so very clinical. It's so very surgical. These are the words, a professional doctor, making an incision on a living body, and that incision is done in such precise terms and such a cool head, as if the person is going to cure. That is called clinical aspect of violence, clinical aspect of cutting and suturing and all those things. And Iago has that kind of clinical outlook. He's never angry. He's all the time planning, and he's planning things in such a manner that you can call him, as I used the word earlier, a finished scoundrel, a finished rascal, a person who has absolutely no inhibition about anything. He has to get things done. So that way, that kind of craftsman, that kind of an intelligent person, that kind of a planner, that kind of an organizer, this is what Iago is. And one of the understandable accusations against Iago would be that he has some kind of a jealousy, that he is driven by jealousy, and that jealousy is at many levels. Maybe he doesn't like Othello because Othello came from outside. He doesn't like Othello because Othello is too big for him. He doesn't like Othello because he's a great fighter, And finally, when the most beautiful, one of the most beautiful women, young women, from the country called Venice, where when she accepts him as her lover and husband, then of course this person's jealousy gets extended to this kind of an extreme that I have brought in and talked about. So maybe that jealousy is the factor. Then Iago at some point of time is talking to himself and talking to others and says, why does Cassio become his lieutenant and I remain his ancient? So maybe he wants some kind of promotion, and because he is not promoted, therefore he wants, you know, to replace Cassio, and he wants to get him killed and all those things. And this is shown in the play. And jealousy eggs him on. But you know, jealousy is there in all of us to a certain extent. But when jealousy takes this kind of an extreme form, then it becomes pathological. Then some kind of a mental disease. It's some kind of psychiatric problem. And maybe it is that Iago has. But I'm using the word maybe, because Shakespeare does not provide any clear answer. And there cannot be any clear answer in a very complex social situation. There are so many factors, involved in such issues that, you know, these factors cannot be separated. Because the moment you separate the factors, then you start focusing upon one better than the other, one higher than the other, which means that the smaller factor actually is pushed into the background and the bigger factor becomes the sole factor. So that's the problem, you know, with analyzing a play. So let's not analyze the play and pinpoint just one particular factor, but then maybe he represents the jealousy of the entire crowd in the country, the entire citizenry in the country. Maybe this country at the unconscious level doesn't like outsiders to come here. There is some kind of social progress is required for a country, and if you don't have as great a general as he has, and if you have a policy, you know, that you send people to other countries and you invite other countries to come here, then of course you have to widen your horizon. And maybe that horizon has been widened in the country and people are allowed to come in here and settle down. And then the settling down of these people, that raises the question of acceptability. Maybe that's the reason that the collective emotion of not being able to tackle an outsider, because the outsider is black, the outsider has thick lips, the outsider is more brave, the outsider is more powerful. So there's a kind of social jealousy that starts working on the minds of the people. Maybe that is the case. Shakespeare, in fact, in this case, you know, becomes relevant even to us. The social jealousy, works in all countries. It works in all communities. It's a negative emotion. It's a dangerous emotion. If human beings have to live and to progress and to become better than before, then one has to overcome such jealousies. But to say that these jealousies can be completely wiped out is difficult. Because, you know, these jealousies will remain for a long time, till the time there are boundaries, till the time there are specific culture, you know, and you can't wipe out cultures. They have a very healthy role to play. So what do? You live with those cultures create a problem, you have to bear with it, at the same time you require that those problems have to be resolved. So this is where I would like to, you know, raise a question which I wish Kitika would raise regarding the use of Shakespeare even in a country like India, which doesn't have any connection with England of Shakespeare's time. So she was referring to when the talk began, she referred right in the beginning to, you know, making of certain films in India adapted, you know, from Shakespeare's plot. So I would like her, in fact, to raise this question here, and then we can take it up in some detail. What is the question, Geetika?
Sir, we talked before the lecture started that we have seen that adaptation, like if we talk about Shakespeare's Othello only, recently a film was directed which was called Omkara, and the film was appreciated, and it was said that it is based on Othello. Mm-hmm. Now the question arises, when we use such terms such as adaptation, when we use somebody's creation and we used to create somebody something else based on the facts given by the original writer. So does these adaptation are justification, or if we take towards the other angle, they preserve what the writer or the creation has been done?
This is an important question. That's why I requested you to initiate it here. Shakespeare, in one sense, belongs not just to England. Shakespeare belongs to all of us. He's a humanist writer. He's a writer who would objectively present situations. He has a moral angle, but that moral angle is the humanist angle. It's not any religious angle. It's not any ethical angle. He doesn't believe in that kind of prejudice of any kind. And he doesn't also believe in the exact definition of right and wrong. But then he has, you know, some kind of a preference for human goodness, good feelings, friendliness, closeness, working together, being a fellow, being a friend. These values he cherishes. And these values, you know, cross boundaries. I don't generally use the word transcend, but then they go beyond the boundaries. So all human beings, you know, belong to one particular species. And this species is spread all around the earth. So in fact, we are not supposed to have any countries. The earth belongs to all the human beings together. Now, if that is the case, at least as an ideal, as a very healthy ideal, if that were to be the case, then Shakespeare is as much England's author as he is India's author. This is one part of the question. So we should adapt, you know, certain films taking help from Shakespeare, and you know, we can make them our own, and we can mix what Shakespeare said and what Shakespeare presented and exhibited in his plays with what we require today. Because after all, one thing that is common between us and Shakespeare is the concern for you know, human strength, human solidarity, human togetherness. At the same time, some kind of you know, feel that things are wrong in those respects, and you know, they have to be fought, they have to be resisted. So one can say that, and so far as Omkara is concerned, this film, I would realize that it's a modern tale, but then the plot is taken straight away from Shakespeare, and when you take the plot from there, and you put it in the Indian conditions, then you are able to focus upon those problems of India, you know, which are allowed by the plot. And Shakespeare is one of the most popular authors in India. He has been translated into a large number of languages all over the world, and India is no exception. Shakespeare would be available in Hindi translation, he would be available in Bangla translation, he would be available in the South Indian languages. And well, if this is what, you know, India, this is how India, you know, receives Shakespeare, then some people would like to also make films based on his plays. And these films are quite popular. I still remember, I think of certain songs, you know, which were presented in Omkara, and those songs became hit songs in their own right. But then one knew, you know, that one was taking the plot and the situations from Shakespeare, and one was able to enjoy the film, and one was able to become aware of the questions that the Indian citizens faced. So would you agree with this?
Sir, definitely I would agree with this. One point is clear. We belong to any country, we belong to any religion, we belong to a one race, that is of a human being. And the emotions are same. If a person is residing in England or in Venice or in India, but the general emotions such as of love, love, hatred, as well as jealousy, these things persist, these emotions persist in every human being. So I feel that if such adaptations are created and the work is presented before the public, I think so, we are telling that yes, everybody of us are alike, whether we reside in any part of the country or whether we reside in any arena, in any era, but things are same.
Deetika, this is precisely what literature does. Literature, you know, demolishes boundaries. Literature demolishes, you know, blockings and, you know, obstructions from life, and keeps people together. Literature offers a kind of a thread to people to bind them in one kind of unity. And particularly Shakespeare contributes to this kind of, you know, human integrity and human unity. So it is for this reason, you know, that he is so popular here. In fact, I said in one other discussion also that Shakespeare became quite popular in India during the national movement. Maybe because Shakespeare believed in some kind of assertion of self, some kind of assertion of freedom. And when one is talking of freedom, and when he's talking of the country, and one is talking of tolerance, one is talking of agreement, one is talking of minorities. And here, you know, one is talking of minorities in this case, the Moors in this country. So Shakespeare then becomes a kind of a torchbearer of a message that will bind the entire humanity in one single thread. And that is what this play does. This play creates a kind of a sympathy for a Moor, for an outsider, a black person, and that person has qualities. Not that the local people don't have qualities, they also have qualities. And one should follow the dictum of the value of quality, and not the character of racism. So racism has no place in a humanist society. And Shakespeare, of course, doesn't say so directly as a playwright, as a writer, but he makes characters say things that strengthen our base in such value system as I'm talking about. Now, to come back to from this general theme and role of Iago, Iago being person who is a character, but also a point of view, and that point of view belongs to a large number of people in a dormant form in that country. Then from that general point, we move on to the specific aspects that we come across in this play. Now, let me inform viewers that there are certain personal details that have to be kept in mind while reading this play. One is Othello is a soldier of the best variety. A person who is fearless, a person who is cool, a person in all situations, a person who uses his weapons well, a person who plans his strategies well, and has spent all his time fighting, planning, strategizing, using tactics, etc., and showing that kind of valor, which is not easily seen anywhere. So he is basically a soldier, a professional soldier, and a professional soldier has weaknesses. Because a professional soldier doesn't know what love is, how to tackle the problem of love. So he'll not be able to even express his love properly to his beloved in the play. And why? How did he fall in love? And how did this girl fall in love with him? Because he can't articulate his emotions well. A soldier can never do that. A soldier is supposed to fight. And then there is a whole scene given to it. And Shakespeare says that the father of the girl one day started asking Othello as to how he spent his earlier life. So he started telling his tale in his own manner, and the girl was listening to him, and they kept listening for days together. Every day he would come, and Desdemona's father would say, okay, now tell me the next thing that happened to you. So he would tell his tale in his own way, and this girl started liking him. He was so nice, he was so brave, he was so innocent. He didn't have all those defects of culture. I like culture as a very high production in human society, but then culture also makes us artificial. So this person is not artificial at all. So he doesn't have that kind of a Venetian culture that others have. But he's a gem. He's a pure person, and he's able to impress this girl with his purity. So the other problem is that Othello, being a soldier, has kept on fighting all his life. He has left his parents behind, and they are no more. He is all alone here. And he is in touch with these people at the level of a general, and then he's liked there, which means that a lot of time has passed by in his case. When would he marry? When would he love, if at all? Will he have a household, or will he die a bachelor? These are the questions that Shakespeare is raising. Here is a young man who joined the army here. He became a general, and he spent most of his time fighting for this country, which is not his country. And now suddenly, a girl starts liking him, and he also says, okay, this is a nice thing, and I should also reciprocate, also respond to her love. So he falls in love with her, and he doesn't know how to express. So this is the situation. And in that, and the other difference is that he is quite senior to her in age. It's a young girl of early 20s. And Othello would be in his mid-30s. So there's a big gap of 10 or 15 years between the two. And yet they are able to communicate. And this factor of age gap, this also can be sometimes utilized by his enemy, who would create a sense of jealousy in Othello. This person has planned it very well. He says he will show some other person as wooing his wife, his beautiful wife, And Othello, you know, would feel, you know, that the wife doesn't love him now after marriage because he's too old for her. So he's using all the tricks of the trade for this kind of a distorted, you know, preference. And you start wondering as to how a person who is a gem, who is a great fighter, is now able to, correspond with, to be able to interact with a woman, you know, who has her charms, who has her qualities, and the two can pull along for some time, but can they last? Can they continue? So these problems are inbuilt in the situation of which Othello is a part. But basically, he is a soldier, and he has all the good traits of a soldier. The other point which I have already discussed, but I can, you know, put it in the perspective here, he is an outsider. So a soldier is fine. If he is a soldier, if he is doing a job, he can be paid for it. So the relationship of the state with the soldier is not that of a human being integrated into society. This is the relationship of a person who is a professional, and as a professional, he can be paid. So why allow him to enter the system that prevails in the society of the time? This question is there, and he'll be treated as an outsider, which is the big problem for Othello. He has married a girl from here, and still he's being treated as an outsider. And there is a person of this country, and this person can take advantage of it. And even though his present is Venetian, his past is of some other country. So that past, you know, starts blocking his present. And Shakespeare is raising this question at so many different levels in the plot. And the last part is that he's a dignitary. So a combination of a soldier, an outsider, and a dignitary. So what do you do with a dignitary? He talks to the top people in the world. He talks to the Duke himself. He's called to all the important meetings. Whenever a decision is taken regarding military action by the country, then he has to be a part of it. So he's that kind of a dignitary. So a large number of people look up to him. But there are many others like Iago who would feel jealous of him. This person is actually reaping benefits of the qualities and the progress that this country has made, and some people are bitter about it. And later on, he'll be as big as the Duke. He'll be a governor of Cyprus, another, you know, it's a kind of a colony now. So he has been sent there, and he will govern that place. So he becomes the top ruler. So this is the quality of Othello that is to be kept in mind. When he talks to his wife, he talks in as an individual. But suppose somebody drops in just at that moment when he talks to his wife, then he becomes a general. And Shakespeare is able to catch, you know, the particular change that occurs in his style and in his behavior and manners. So this is the, you know, complex situation that Shakespeare has presented for us look at and to appreciate. Let's talk about Desdemona then. She is a daughter. Every woman initially is a daughter. She has been, you know, born in a family, and she, you know, inherits the traits of the family. And what she loves initially is the person who gave birth to her, the mother and the father. And therefore, this person is a daughter. But when she grew up and became, you know, a young woman, at that point of time, he had lost her mother, because there's no mother in the play of Desdemona. Therefore, she has her father, and the father dotes on her. And he wants this girl to settle down in the same place and marry somebody else. And she says no, she doesn't want to marry. And when later on, you know, she knows that the father will never allow her to marry a black, to marry a Moor, to marry a person from outside. Therefore, she has married secretly Othello. So, which means that she has ceased to be a daughter. So, she was a daughter, and she was going by the dictates of her father. But later on, when she realized that she was in love with somebody else, and that the father would always say no, he will reject her idea. Therefore, she didn't tell him, and that was a breach of trust. And human beings always, you know, breach these trusts. After all, a person is not always a daughter. A person also becomes a wife. A person also later becomes a mother, if we talk of women. And the same is true about men. So they keep changing their roles in life. And Desdemona is that kind of an honest person. that when the role comes, she'll take it, with courage, and she'll perform it properly. She'll not hurt anybody's feeling unnecessarily, but when it comes to defining her role, then she can tell her father very clearly, yes, I'm your daughter, and in certain respects, I'll always obey you, but now I'm also a wife, now I'm also a lover, and I want to pursue my interests. And the father, of course, would never like it, but then the girl has the right to say that she's a daughter, and she at the same time is a lover and a wife. In fact, this particular idea I also brought in the discussion on King Lear, where one of the three daughters says the same thing. So it carries a shade of that particular daughter, Cordelia, and Desdemona has that, and so which means that she's an individual. She's not just a daughter. Every woman is a daughter of somebody, but she's an individual. Individual means she's Desdemona. She's not a father's daughter. She's not a daughter of the family. She's not a person only from Venice. She's a human being. So, she's an individual then. She'll decide on her own as a single person. This is what I want, and I'll do it. And if you think that I'm wrong, then you can discuss with me, and I'll tell you my choice. But then I think it is right, and Shakespeare presents her as a right person. Therefore, he gives her the guts to assert herself, come forward, and tell everybody clearly that this is what she wants. So she's an individual, and this individuality is unknown to the Elizabethan audience. In fact, in our case in India, even till today, it's very difficult to be an individual. How can you say, well, I believe in this and therefore I'll do it? If you say that, then the entire community goes against you. And it requires the real courage, to come forward and say, yes, I belong to the community, I know its values, but I'll pursue them, all those values, in my own way. If you say that, if you do it individually, then many people will raise their eyebrows. They would not like you to talk like this. They would say, no, you should say, traditions are more important, individual is not important. And the individual will say, yes, traditions are important, but I have a right to criticize them. And I have to slightly modify them. And I have to also the right to accept certain traditions. But this I word is anathema to social organizations. They don't want to hear the word I. They always want to hear the word all of you or all of us, but never I. But then, well, society is such in the modern times, and Shakespeare is one of the modern authors, even in the 16th, 17th century. English criticism calls that period early modern period. So it's not a medieval period. It's not an ancient period. It's a modern period. And the modern phenomena in society would always give rise to a kind of individualism. The person as a self, the person as an individual, the person who says, I would like to do this. And Desdemona has that kind of individuality and individualism in her. And this individualism, this individuality is not wrong in her case, because she is taking a position which is in favor of love, in favor of communion with another human being on the level of equality. Then, she is a daring social rebel. The third, which is also connected with individuality. They appear to be two different things. On the one side, I say she has individuality. On the other side, I say she is a social rebel. Why don't I say she is an individual rebel? This is the question, I can raise from myself. And you can also raise this question and ask this question from me, from others, and also from yourselves. Are individuals social rebels? Yes. In a context where you are flouting certain norms which society blindly follows, blindly, then the society is wrong and the individual is right. Why do blindly? Why don't you do it, with open eyes, rationally? Why can't you sustain a point rationally in society? Discuss rationally and then come to a conclusion. Give everybody a chance to discuss and differ with one another, and then you reach a conclusion. That's what a social rebellion means. And she is a social rebel. The states knows very well that the individuals have the right to marry a person of their choice. And this is clear from before the meeting that is taking place in one of the scenes. And she is asked whether she has married him by her own choice. And she says, yes, I have married him. So they accept. But then the father says, no, I will not accept this. So it is this that becomes an act of social rebellion on her part. She is rebelling against those social notions which are entrenched in orthodoxy. So she goes against orthodoxy, she brings in modernity, she is far ahead of her times, and therefore I would call her a daring social rebel, because she can leave her father. She will never go back to him. Later on, she will get the news that the father is dead. And he is never allowed to enter her, you know, after marriage. But she said, okay, I'll pay the price for this and I'll live with my husband. I've chosen him. So she's that kind of a modern woman and a lover. Then, you know, at the individual level, she's visualized as a beautiful, good-looking human being. And I say good-looking is young people generally are good-looking. But then she's a beautiful human being, which means she has the good qualities, and she charms people by her qualities. So why has Shakespeare made her such an exclusive person? Is the question one can ask. After all, Shakespeare doesn't believe any kind of elitism, and he doesn't think, you know, that beauty lies only in the physical attributes. The point that Shakespeare is making is that if she is physically beautiful, then people will always think of, you know, possessing her. Young people will be madly after her, you know, and it is at that time that Shakespeare would get a chance to say, this woman has decided to marry none of those people who were madly in love after her, who were madly after her, but somebody else who was her choice. So, you know, this gives Shakespeare a chance to use, you know, the beautiful, you know, attributes of a girl, good attributes of a girl, in order to draw the attention of a large number of people in the city. Suppose she didn't have that kind of looks, then the Venetians wouldn't bother about her. Okay, let her marry anybody she wants to marry. But in this case, the whole town, the whole place, you know, where she lives, they think that this is a beautiful girl, and why not that one of them, you know, a person from the place would actually get her hand. So these things are there in Desdemona. I use the word individuality. I also use the word daring. I use the word rebellion, and a beautiful human being. It's a wonderful combination, and this kind of a combination is not easy to get, not easy to see, and she has it. So she is a lovable character in Shakespeare, and you know that heightens the effect of tragedy, because such a lovable person, when she is killed by her loving husband, just because he is jealous that somebody else is wooing her, this will intensify the effect of tragedy. So the play is tragic for this reason also, that one of the finest human beings, a person who, you know, loved another and who would do anything to please that person, if that person was killed by a person who was suspicious as a husband, then the fault is not her at all. It's a kind of a reflection on the conflicts in society at that time. And well, the effect would be that there will be great sense of loss when the play ends. And one you know gets to know that she has been killed, then people go back to their homes with tears in their eyes, and much more than tears, they have a kind of pain in their mind and body, and that pain can't be easily relieved. You can't forget this play after you have read it once or seen it on the stage once in its pure form. Then you would never forget this play, because in this play this person didn't have any fault, and the fault was not there even in the lover who killed her. The fault was there somewhere else. The fault was there in Iago, and Iago was a Venetian, and he was using the argument of being a Venetian to the hilt. So imagine Shakespeare is able to weave, you know, this kind of a you know situation, complex situation, just on the basis of the core issue of this fight between Iago on one side, and Othello on the other, and Othello loses, and the price is paid by him and his beloved. And they got completely destroyed. So these two people, I thought I should discuss them in some detail with you. And well, I've finished most of it. So I'll take another 3-4 minutes to wind up the discussion. There is another person in the play who, to my mind, is as relevant and significant as Emilia, as Desdemona, and her name is Emilia. In fact, when I was thinking about this play after having finished it, I realized that Emilia seems to be a very integral part of the perspective, sequence of qualities that Desdemona has. She seems to be an extension of Desdemona. Desdemona is innocent because she is newly married and she was just a young woman, inexperienced. Emilia has been married with Iago, She doesn't know that Iago is a villain, but she has been married with him, and therefore she knows the ways of the world. She understands very clearly that the entire male community in the system, in the country at that point of time, is ranged against women. In fact, one of the comments that she makes when she realizes that her husband or has done this kind of a thing, or Othello is cruel to his wife, who is the friend of Emilia, then at one point of time, she says very clearly that men are stomachs. See the lines that Shakespeare is using from her. Emilia speaks this dialogue. She says, men are stomachs and women are food. So in a way, men consume women. So what kind of society is this, where women have no personality and they don't eat anything, they in fact are eaten. So such a violent image is being used by Shakespeare in order to say, and this is the pain of all women in England at that time. I'm sure this is the pain of all women all over the world even today, that men do not treat them as their equals. They always treat them as an item of consumption. So she is good only when she is 20 or 30, but when she is 40 or 50, then she's not good at all. So what kind of society is this where men of all ages can feel important and women are important only till they are attractive in their looks? So it's a very a pertinent kind of a phrase, and it's a very great expression of pain that this person projects through that line, that men are stomachs and women are food. Then I'll go to the conclusion part of the discussion. And I would say that this play is a tragedy, and even when the play has ended and every good person has died, most good person have died, then also we have a sense of pain, we have a sense of loss, but as I said in the previous discussion, we have no pessimism. Because all these people who died at the end, or who killed, Othello killed his wife, these people actually give us the message of a very intense kind of moral system, a very, very immense kind of human moral system. No, not the moral system in the usual sense of the word. And that, we should try to live and live beautifully and live with one another and in a bond of relationship, in a bond of love. And that if things go against us, then we would die, but then we will not stop aspiring for that for which we wanted to live all our lives. So this is a kind of, message that comes across to us. And I believe that this is the message for which Shakespeare would use all his skills of writing and his entire creative artistic endeavor. So this is where I finish. And
yes, sir, as we have no time left with us right now, but still I would say through this lecture we try to understand about Shakespeare's Othello also, as well as through you we try to understand about the human values and emotions which persist I think with everybody, with everyone, whether male, female, or human community as a whole. And I hope that all the students who might have watched this lecture would be benefited. Dear friends, if you want to access this lecture once again, then I would say then you can access this lecture with the help of YouTube, on which we are going to upload it very soon. We would be meeting again with Shakespeare's one of the another creations in our future sessions. Till then, take care, goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thanks.